Hey, welcome to the channel. My name is Jason, and here I talk about all things story. And yes, folks, we have made it full year. Well, over a year, as if you know, it's taken me 48 episodes or so to hit a year, but 52. This marks the end of year one regarding the anthology. So this is the final story that will be in the anthology. Episode 53 will carry into year two. So keep a lookout for that. I'm assembling it as I'm recording this. Well, not as I'm recording this, but I'm assembling it. So hopefully it doesn't take too long. I think I'm just going to hire an editor to do a proofread. I don't think I wanted to get too in detail with the prose itself because, again, I'm dealing with that 1,000-word limitation, and I could see that quickly getting out of hand. But let's talk about the music. Funny thing about the music. So I started listening to the soundtrack for The Proposition by Warren Ellis and Nick Cave. And it's a fantastic soundtrack. It's a unique soundtrack. However, there are a few songs that have vocals, and it was really throwing me off. And I don't want to blame the music on the reason why this story took me so long to write, but I had to switch it about halfway through. And the soundtrack I switched to was The Salvation, starring Mads Mikkelsen. It's by various artists, which weren't listed in my playlist, so I can't, unfortunately, give them any credit. But it was more of a traditional soundtrack. It was less like what Warren Ellis and Nick Cave tend to do, but instrumentation, that's what I needed. So you've seen the thumbnail, you know why I chose it. So let's check out this week's artwork. This week's artwork is titled The Lookout. It is by a matte painter and concept artist at Brown Bag Films named Gavin O'Donnell from Dublin, Ireland. So why did I pick this one? Well, I haven't really done a Western since episode 2, so long ago. I did one that was kind of more of a Cormac McCarthy-esque modern Western, but not full-on Western in a while, so I decided that this would be it. It's been a long time. This is the final episode, closing the first year one of the anthology, and so why not? And images like these I enjoy because looking out of frame is such a powerful thing that you don't see that often. A lot of times you see characters in these paintings looking at something in the frame. Now, I know this is called The Lookout, and so he is looking out for people who may be hindering what he's trying to do. But still, I feel like there's a lot of interest there because you do not know what he's looking at, and so you get to concoct that. Or I get to concoct that when I write the story. There's not much really else to say. There's this kind of ruined building behind the figure. There's a barrel that looks shot up with some whiskey glasses or something, or bottles up on top of it, a wagon wheel, odds and ends. And then we have this figure with a rifle slung over his shoulder, and he's got a bandana around his face, like any bandit worth his salt, right? So anyway, I should have a good time with this one. We'll see how it goes. Thanks, Gavin. Love the artwork. I love your stuff. You don't have a lot of stuff up yet, so hopefully we get to see more. So that said, let's see what I came up with. Couldn't breathe worth a damn. Blue hot sky beating Ambrose with a switch the size of, well, the sky. Look at Carlo. Son of a bitch paddling around that swimming hole of mud as if that's where he'd find it. Brave for a man who couldn't swim, but Ambrose was the climber anyhow, and had better eyes, so the top of the rock was his spot. Carlo was still wearing his kerchief, too, as if Ambrose could make out his face from here, the fool. Their only rule, only names, no faces. Ambrose scratched his shoulder with his rifle because that's where it was. Gunmetal like fire on his naked hands, trigger finger sweating something fierce. He reached for his kerchief, caught sight of the hand that had done the bloody deed, and thought different for some reason. Should have shaved this morning, but he didn't have a blade anyhow. Would have used it for the deed too. Cutting throats with blades is easier than with fingernails, though his were razor sharp, hard to make a fist. That old braided Indian had taught him why claws were better than fists. More than whiskers itched on Ambrose's face at that thought. In three distinct lines that still hurt when it got too hot, like today. Funny how he couldn't feel a finger on his face, but those scars burned like rivers of fire all by themselves. Even she wouldn't touch him there, ugly as it was. He hadn't blamed her, but he still killed her, with those nails the chief learned him of. Hair spread around her like nightfall. He stroked that hair long after she died. Now both their spirits haunted him, leading him and Carlo off course from what they'd earned. What I earned. Ambrose pushed through his teeth, the eye splitting the we in two as he spied Carlo hauling something up out of the muck. Ambrose shifted his stance in what must have been hours, legs cored by stone as brittle as the stone behind him. He trained his rifle on Carlo's fat dollop of a body. Fuck if he was pale, necking up and elbows down as dark as the mud he climbed out of. Ambrose returned the rifle to his shoulder and made a fist. Drew something hot there he knew wasn't sweat. Slapped that fat bastard in the face with the blood. The smell and taste of it would throw him off course long enough for Ambrose to fire a shot into his belly. Maybe two. Fall back into that mud, sink down, preserved for someone else to find 1,000 years from now, after it all dried up. And this goddamn sun, Ambrose said, pulling his arm across his forehead. When Ambrose saw Carlo had found an old empty crate and not the prize they were after, he shuffled to the one barrel in 100-mile radius he hadn't shot up, but was, and took a swig of a memory. The bottle, left empty for some time, abandoned by someone else. But closing his eyes, he thought he might feel the spirit of what used to be trickle down his throat, like the two spirits that both scorched his face and wouldn't touch it. He threw the bottle against the ruined wall. It felt good, but seeing all that glass sparkle in the dust made him think of rain. Hands planted on the windowsill, nails embedded into rotted wood, Ambrose couldn't win. He kicked a bucket in his path that turned to dust as he rounded the corner to find shade or answers or solace, but more than likely dirt. Ambrose did find dirt, but also something else. Planks beneath the dirt of what used to be a floor. Who the hell would live up here, closer to the sun than anyone wanted to be? Ambrose took to what little shade there was and considered his question. He kicked aside some dirt, and what he thought was grains of sand scatter on tiny legs. The ground gave more than it should. Now why'd you go and do that? It was Carlo, caked in dried mud, kerchief the only clean thing on him. No faces, and now I've two reasons, you ugly fuck. Ambrose looked around at the source of Carlo's dismay. He saw more of his nose than he should have. His kerchief was off. Now I'm gonna have to kill you, Carlo said, revolver aimed. Along with his kerchief, Ambrose had misplaced his rifle. A shame, really, Carlo said. A tough solo haul this is gonna be. Ambrose stepped toward him. You found it? Hey, 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 Carlo said. Watch it. Ambrose did, to the floor that matched the sill and the bucket. He smoothed dirt back over the spot. Carlo frowned and smiled. You hiding some from me, Brosie? Nuh-uh, don't go doing that. Stay put. Ambrose dropped to the ground and a ball and broke through, taking Carlo along with him. Then Ambrose fell through something again, water. Plunging deep, the only thing he could feel were those scratches on his face. He found the surface somehow and emptied his lungs onto a ledge of slick rock and kicked his feet to stay afloat, water the only purchase below he could find. Convinced he wasn't going to drown yet, he listened for the man who surely had. Not a splash or gurgle or weak grasp on his shoe. Ambrose smiled and looked up to a hole full of blue-hot sky. His scars weren't burning for once, and it troubled him. He reached up for a handhold, found one, but his weight tore all his nails off except his thumbs. Just as he reached his other hand up, light fell on it, then shadow, crawling across it like termites. Above were two silhouettes, one with braids, one without. Sharp nails that weren't his clacked on stone and echoed around him. That and the darkness were all he was left with. I do believe I'm going to do this whole thing with a southern accent. No, I'm kidding. As fun as that would be, it would be difficult, probably annoying. And this one took a long time. So On another note, I've sped this up 5 times because it took me nearly 2 hours to complete the story. And I don't know why I chose this image. I loved it so much when I saw it. It was just scanning down the page. I said, that's it. However, because there isn't really inherent conflict, it made it more difficult, as I always say. However, we do have the element of this man looking off. Does he see anything? Is he waiting for something? What is it? What is it he's looking for? And also, who is, or what's the deal with this ruined building he's by? Anyway, I was thinking about all of these things as I wrote. And when I have no idea where I'm going, when I have no inspiration, when I don't see an ending quick enough, what do? I start describing the scene. And so that's exactly what I did here, talking about him not being able to breathe worth a damn, the hot blue sky beating Ambrose with a switch the size of, well, the sky, et cetera, et cetera. I'm just trying to paint the picture. One thing that I will go back, you know, once I do the editing that I felt like I didn't succeed at is completely painting the picture, right? And I don't think you need to, when you're writing something, when you're setting a scene, you don't really have to explain the entire thing. However, while I was reading it, I was wondering if it was clear. Did it give the reader enough of a picture in their head to understand what was going on? I did mention him rounding corners and there's a wall and, you know, there's some kind of semblance of a house, but I don't think I was explicit enough. And so that's probably one regret I have in this story. And this one was, I mean, I really, really struggled. I established who he was looking at. He wasn't looking at anybody. So normally, you know, a lookout, I feel like, is, you know, watching the other direction while somebody's doing something else, right? So they don't get caught. Or maybe there's something going on in this building and he's just keeping an eye out to see if anybody's approaching. What I did is I decided this was one man with a partner, up to no good. And that man's name is Carlo, who's off digging in the muck, looking for some kind of prize, which I never really say what it is, but I think that's okay. I feel like that's more interesting, is keeping it a mystery, because really that's not what the story is about. What is this story about? The story is about a man named Ambrose, and he has a dark past. He killed an Indian chief, allegedly. And this is kind of a weird thing. I don't even know where this came from. It's so bizarre. But I noticed his hand clenched in a fist. And, you know, normally when you're standing somewhere, you're not clenching a fist. Your hand is relaxed and your fingers are, you know, just hanging down. And so I wondered, like, what's the deal there? And so I did tie that into the story, you know, when he clenches his fingers with his sharp nails. But that's the weird part, right? Why does this guy have sharp nails? I don't know. I guess I decided there was an Indian chief who, like, decided to, he thought he was Wolverine or something, and he had this affinity for sharp nails and wounded our friend Ambrose here with those nails. And so Ambrose saw the usefulness in such things. I know it's very random. It's not very Western-like, but, you know, what the hell? I don't know. I feel like little things like that, as weird as they may be or stupid as they sound, they add a little bit of something. So I did it. And then he also killed this woman. And I really struggled the entire time because I established the fact of something that he did in his past that got him here, either, you know, gave him his clawed hands, essentially, his wound that just doesn't ever stop burning. And so that's why I decided to end it that way. It took a long time. I didn't really know where things were going. I just decided randomly to have Carlo show up unexpected, right when he was investigating this, looking for shade, investigating this ruin. And that's where it went. It went down to a confrontation between these two men. And at first, when I was writing it, I had Ambrose escape because I did see the fact that he's a climber. He's a climbing man. And that's really one thing that I had to do here, is because I think a lot of times when you're writing a story and you know where you're going, the foreshadowing just comes naturally because you know the end. And so you want to pepper these little things in there that are little breadcrumbs and clues to the reader as to what might happen without being too overt. However, I didn't know where I was going. I didn't have any of those things. And so during the editing phase, that's exactly what I had to do. I had to go back and try to foreshadow some things. I guess maybe make some more specific things around the two Indians who were Native Americans who were looking down at him in spirit, let's say. And I like that mystery too, right? We know that they're both dead, yet he sees them above. Is it their spirits? Is it someone else doing it? And then he just sees them because he said that they've been haunting him, his mind, ever since. But that's what I had to do. I had to give some defining features to those people. So, you know, I made sure to call attention to the woman's hair as well as the chief's hair because, you know, in silhouette, there's really not a much, there's not many things you can see, right? It's all about contours, and I guess I could have done like a headdress or something like that, but maybe that's a little too stereotypical. Hell, I mean, braids are probably too stereotypical. I guess at the very least I left the woman's hair down and the man's hair braided. But anyway, I don't know what I'm talking about. None of that really matters. Just the only thing that matters is that I added those things after the fact to give a direction. So I feel like if you're not foreshadowing in your stories, think about it. It's a very powerful tool. It's something that every storytelling medium does, from film. And it just makes everything just feel nice. I don't know. It feels like, you know, when you get to the end and you have all these images that you've kind of seen and then subconsciously, you know, stowed away in your brain. You don't always remember them, but I think that it's part of the craft that really helps, because it's not that you're trying to, you know, hint necessarily, like you don't want to give it away, right? Because I think that's the balancing act with foreshadowing, is sometimes people are very heavy handed with it and you immediately are like, oh, this is going to happen. That happens probably more likely in movies because, you know, less time to do it, but you'll see an obvious image or a scene or a gesture or an object or something like that, and you're like, okay, this is too obvious. This is what's going to happen in the story or in the film. Or it could be a misdirection as well. You know, it could be sort of an ironic misdirection, which I would much prefer things like that to subvert expectations. But anyway, what else about this thing? Yeah, I was just stuck. I was getting words out. You can see here, 45 minutes in, I'm about 600 words. It took me about 3 or 4 minutes, I think, to even start this whole thing. But that doesn't matter. What matters is I got to have a story. And I remember when I was writing this, I was just thinking like, oh, well, maybe I'll just have it be like I always tell myself, like, don't stress too much out about making it a clever story or anything like that, or a story with a definitive end to the character you're seeing there. Just make it a moment. I felt like, you know, the Junkyard story was like that. Felt like the last one I did was like that. There's no explanations. There's mystery still there, which is important. And I need to continue to remind myself of that. But this one I did make an end to. I ended this man. And whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, I don't know. Sometimes I think that I like the eternal nature of stories, right? As much as people like endings, they like to know that things continue on to some degree, right? The characters live on. Their story doesn't end with the last word. And unfortunately, that's kind of what I did. I ended this guy. I ended both of these men. That's okay too. That's a different approach. But the more I think about it, the more I like the idea of not definitively ending what's going on, unless it appears to be an end. You know, if it's like a massive battle and there's just dead bodies everywhere, then, you know something happened and you should tell that story or not. Leave it a mystery. But the fact of the matter is I need to stop trying to be clever. Not that I'm particularly clever, but, you know, not try to think of ways to make someone feel like, okay, this story has a beginning and a middle and an end. And I know it sounds like I'm going against any kind of story craft recommendations or advice, but I don't know. Vignettes are fun sometimes. There's plenty of great vignettes I've read in books. I think Dan Simmons' The Hyperion was a fantastic book about particularly the Poet's Tale, when he created these vignettes and things. They're just sometimes so interesting that you don't need anything else, right? Not to say that the story is that interesting, but, you know, sometimes just if a scene is that great and you have someone invested and you have someone just completely enthralled, that's really what you want to do, right? You want to just capture them and hook them and keep them for whatever it is you're going to tell them or show them or whatever medium you're working in. But anyway, I don't know. I'm rambling. I'm trying to fill the time. I have an hour left to talk about this. So maybe let's take a look at the words themselves and see what's going on here. So this is the confrontation with Carlo. I've established that they're, I don't know if I've gone back and written it yet, but that's one thing I did fail to mention is that I decided that these two men didn't know their identities. They knew their names, which those names could be very fake, or they could, you know, be the real names, but they cannot see their faces because those things they can't really change. And it looks like our friend is being betrayed. Hey, 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 Carlos said, watch it. And Ambrose did. And this is when I decide to bring the house down, so to speak. And they fall into the water. And, you know, I foreshadow after this that the man can't swim. You know, when he's digging around in the swimming hole full of mud, you know, Ambrose points out that that's not a smart thing to do for a man in his shape or skill. But yeah, I'm just honestly right now, I'm just kind of biding my time. I'm not really, I'm kind of feeling it out on the page. And I think that this one was a lot of that. It was a lot of figuring it out. I never felt like anything came easy in this one whatsoever. Even after finishing it and feeling like, okay, I foreshadowed some things. Things seem logical. Yes, I could probably do a bit better with some of the scene setting. But, you know, it's fine. It's one of these stories. It's fine. And unfortunately, I wish I would have ended on a high note. I wish I would have written one of my better stories to be the final one in the anthology and to, you know, mark the end of the year of doing this. But alas, it is what it is. These aren't planned. They just happen, and that's what they are. And I think that I will try to continue to say that message, because one thing I would hate to do is only release videos with stories that I felt were exceptional, because, you know, I want these to be, you know, I'm not making these videos to just, hey, look at how impressive this tale is. Not by any stretch, right? It's to show people like yourselves, people who are writing any kind of story, scripts, you know, novels, short stories, comics, graphic novels, et cetera, that sometimes it just sucks, you know, sometimes it doesn't work itself out. And also to trust your subconscious, right? I know it's easy for me to say when you're dealing with only 1,000 words, because going back and editing is extremely easy as opposed to writing a, you know, 50,000 word plus manuscript and going back and trying to make out a sense of it. But I mean, I don't know what else to tell you. Like, some of it is just, some of the magic happens in those moments. It's really weird. I mean, I do definitely get epiphanies on when I'm outlining sometimes, you know, out and about doing, not even thinking about the story, and something hits me. But I don't know. I think what I love about it, honestly, and I don't think I would ever in a million years pants an entire novel again. I did that with my first book. And as fun as it was to explore that, it's just too much mess to clean up. I know Stephen King does it. Stephen King is a better man than I am, clearly. Clearly much more successful. But anyway, yeah, I just, with these, it's kind of like a cool exercise, almost, if you think about it, like a chapter, right? Because a chapter should be a scene. Now, it doesn't have to contain every single element. You don't have to fully resolve every chapter. You should not. You should leave it unresolved. And if you do resolve something in a chapter, you need to open up a bigger next thing, right? But this happens, or, and then this happens, right? This is bigger thing. Yes, this problem has been solved, but something else, dun, 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 has happened. And, man, where am I going with this? I have no idea. I'm just, like I said, trying to fill the time, because I don't want to have to edit this too much. And plus, I don't want to just cut too much out of it. So you think I'm pulling a fast one and not really, writing in real time and just kind of using the editing and the magic of editing. But yeah, anyway, I think that the moral of the story, what I'm trying to get across is that I want to put everything out there. I want people to think, I want to fail, you know, like I want people to read these and be like, man, that's not, and then read another one of mine and go, wow, that was really good. Because you're never just knocking it out of the park every time. And despite the fact that I have plenty of stories in this series that I'm just not a huge fan of, there are those ones that are gold that I'm so glad, that make me so glad that I'm doing this, because I would have never had those stories if I didn't decide to just kind of take the plunge and decide to do it. It really reminds me of, I'm not sure if anybody watching this ever watches Joel Haver, but he's a YouTuber who has exploded to success. He's got over 1 million subs. He went from something like 20,000 to over 1 million. And like, I feel like it's been like a few months, not even that long, but He's a great filmmaker. He's showing people that you do not need a $1 billion budget to make anything great. You don't need a budget at all. And he's living his dream. But anyway, oh yeah, he's touring. If you don't know him, check him out, Joel Haber. He's on YouTube. I just said that. I know. Why am I telling you this? But he bought a van and he's going around the US making films with people he meets along the way. I mean, how cool is that? That's so cool. But what I love about it is his philosophy on creativity. And he's a young guy. Well, I'm an old guy, so he's young to me. Maybe not young to you. But his idea is just keep making stuff, because you're going to make a lot of shitty stuff, but you're also going to make some good stuff in the mix. And I've wholeheartedly agree with that. I found that extensively. If I could pull like maybe 5 of these stories out of the 52 I've written that I really, really love, and I think it's probably about that number, honestly, maybe less. But those ones to me were worth the entire ride. And, you know, not to say that any of these stories are just complete crap. I think some of them are just like, you know, a lot of people will probably read it and shrug and be like, meh, whatever. It was fine. I mean, that's what happens though, right? I can't tell you of an anthology I've ever read where I've read every single story and they've been amazing. I do have the benefit of using art as writing prompts. So artists, if you are listening to this or watching this on YouTube, thank you. I thank you very much, because coming up with this many ideas would be a tough one. I could probably just sit around and start with a sentence and a premise and just go and see what happens. But I don't think I would have the diversity of what I have. And there's no way I would have thought of the variety of things in terms of like settings and genres that these artists have provided me with. All right, we are sitting at 1:40. And now I am seating. I'm foreshadowing. I'm adding all these little details that hopefully bring it to a satisfying conclusion. You can see my clock is ticking away. It's 12:32 a.m. I started too late on this one, but that's another frustrating thing too, is I like to write at night. I don't know. I know a lot of people are morning writers, but I just really love the solitude of the evening, the quiet. And I know the morning is quiet too, but I also like the darkness. So, and yeah, I guess if you get up early enough, it's still dark. But anyway, just even though I this is a late one for me, I got it done. You know, I finished it. I was like, screw it. I'm going to keep going until I get this damn thing done. And I'm about to wrap it up. I'm just cleaning up these final few words here. And I'm sorry, man, this was a rambly ramble. This was probably more rambly than I've been in a long time. And I don't know. I used to go line by line by these things, and now I just kind of wing it and sometimes talk about the story and try to create some kind of odd message about writing craft. Let me know what you think. Like, do you like these more just talking about craft and then using the story as kind of a jumping off point as far as what I learned? Or would you prefer me to talk about the line by line stuff? I know this one, I feel like I've talked pretty much about all there is to say about the story, so I didn't go too deep into it, and partially because that's, you know, why it's just all right. It's all right. So 9:97, clocking in. Oh man, we're at 1:48. I think we're almost done though. I'm just playing with words here, trying to, you know, the funny thing is too, is when I get to the end of these sometimes, and I find that I find two words that should actually be one word, and then I'm like, oh, I totally cheated. But that's okay. It is what it is. You know, seat of your pants. That's going to happen. But I try my best to make sure it's accurate. And man, I went farther than I thought. Look at this. Am I going to hit 2 hours? I don't know. Maybe it's going to happen. Maybe I'm looking how can I take one word away? Just one. Well, there it is. There it is. Perfect. Look at that.
Welcome to the end, dear viewer. I'm so glad you made it. This is where I talk about my final thoughts, what I felt like were good things about the story, bad things, and on and on and on. First and foremost, you know that this took a long time to write. It was just a hair under 2 hours, and I didn't know where I was going. I didn't have any ending in sight. Even up until the very end, that's kind of when I decided, okay, I guess this is how it's going to go down. And then I decided to add foreshadowing elements previously, so it didn't feel like it came out of nowhere, because I think, and that is the key thing I took away with this, is that, you know, I learned about foreshadowing a long time ago. Everyone, I feel like, knows the concept. However, if you do not know the concept, if you're just starting out and getting into storytelling, then I'll explain it to you really quickly. So foreshadowing is when you add very subtle elements. It could be imagery, it could be lines of dialogue, it could be interior thoughts or indirect thoughts that hint at or feel like they're part of a thematic whole to the culmination, to the climax. It is a very delicate balancing act, though, however, because you don't want to be too obvious. You don't want your story to become predictable. And a lot of times in films or books, if your foreshadowing is a little bit too heavy-handed, that's the risk. So, and it's one of those things that a lot of times you have to go back and add in, because you know, you don't know how the story is going to completely unfold beat by beat unless you're a person who has incredibly thorough outlines, which that is not me. So this is a great example in this story, is where once I got to the end, once I figured out how the conclusion was going to happen, and I was actually second guessing myself. I was thinking maybe I should let this guy live. Maybe even though he's a terrible person, maybe I should let him climb out. And that's what I started doing, where I was seeding the idea that he was a good climber in like the first or second paragraph. And I changed my mind. And that's what's great, right? You can change your mind anytime you want. However, you got to understand that the implications of that storytelling-wise, foreshadowing, I made sure to add the visual descriptions of the chief and the woman that he killed to make sure that last bit made sense. Hopefully it made sense, because you did see them in silhouette. So I had to identify some physical aspects that would be visible in silhouette. So I know it sounds granular, but I think these are the things. I'm a very visual writer, at least I attempt to be, and I'm always trying to picture these scenes vividly in my head. It's almost like writing a film, seeing a film unfold before your eyes. And that's one of the things I love about writing, is it's a linear progression much of the time. And it's as if you're the camera just following these characters around. And sometimes that camera lens turns on something unexpected. And so you got to go back and foreshadow some things. And I wouldn't say that the foreshadowing here was particularly interesting or great or anything like that. I just want to, I thought it was a great example to show you how after the fact, sometimes you have to add some stuff in. I guess that's about it. What did I like about it? I don't know. I mean, I think I had the best time with writing in the Western way. Whether or not I'm good at it or not, I have a blast doing it. It's just a different cadence of writing. It's different word choice, and it's a lot of fun for me. Maybe I'm missing my calling. Maybe I should be writing Westerns. I don't know. Bad things. Well, I don't think it's inherently a very good story. It's okay. It's not terrible. But again, as I talked about in the writing analysis, if I can find a handful of great stories in these 52, then I have succeeded, because it's all about just continually creating art and creating content to make sure that you're stretching yourself a little bit. That was the entire intention of this series, is to stretch myself, to try different things, jump around in genres, try different characterization, different POVs, all of that stuff. And I feel like there are some really good ones in the bunch. However, it is the vast minority, but that's okay. That's the point. Hopefully, if you're a writer or just a lover of storytelling, if you've gotten some stuff out of this, maybe it's inspired you to understand that you're not always going to nail it the first time. And that is why I'm putting every story out I write, because I don't want to just focus on the really polished ones, right? Because I don't want everybody to think that, oh, wow, this is just how writing is supposed to be. You knock it out of the park every time. It's like, in fact, that is the opposite. Most of the time you create a lot of content that just is not great at all. So that's why it's all here. Hope you enjoy it. Love it or hate it, it's here for you to see. So if you would like to support the channel, give me a thumbs up, like this video if you liked it, subscribe for story related content, check out all my links in the description. I have books on Amazon. I do live streams occasionally. I'm missing this weekend, unfortunately, going out of town again. But most importantly, the most important thing you can do, keep reading, keep writing, and I will see you next week. Thanks. Bye. If you'd like to read the story in its non-video format, check the link in the description. I didn't edit anything else. Promise. Thanks again.